Hallelujah. How's everybody today? Blessed and highly favored. Everyone say, I have a choice to be miserable or to be joyful. God has already given me the choice. Amen. You want to be miserable? Go for it. Amen. Now, listen, just make sure if you are a believer, don't tell anybody you know Jesus, because Jesus is never miserable. Amen. He's joyful. You know, the word says that count it all joy when you go through trials and tribulations. Don't be miserable. Just count it as joy. Why? It's training. See, your trials and tribulations expose your impurities and your enemy. So in these trials and tribulations, we're to get our eyes off of ourselves and get them on the Lord so that he can show us what's going on. If we're not willing to look, we'll stay in a place of deception. And that's Satan's greatest weapon, is deception. Is everybody okay? Oh, praise God. Are you ready? Amen. Remember, this is not about religion. This is a military operation established by the King of Glory named Jesus, who is the Lord of the army. We are in training sessions. This is no religious garbage. We had enough of that. Amen. Jesus is Lord of the army. He's the King of Kings, Lord of Lords, and he's God Almighty who came into the flesh. But now he sits at the right hand of the Father, interceding for me and you. Amen. And he left us his spirit. Hallelujah. Amen. That's why he's called Holy Spirit. Amen. Yeah. So you and I can have power. But see, religion don't want you to know that stuff. The devil's behind all religion. Jesus is behind all truth. Amen. Would you turn to Exodus chapter 25? These are manuals. You know, when I had my visitation from the Lord over 23 years ago, his first words out of his mouth was, my Bible is true. Amen. And I realized it was a training manual. Glory. Exodus 25. Is everybody there? Amen. Just trying to see if my glasses match my shirt. I guess they didn't match it. Hallelujah. They look purple from this end. Hallelujah. They still look purple. Exodus 25. Is everybody there? Verse 1. Then the Lord, let's speak it together. Remember, the word of God, these are words that have been spoken. God's words don't stop. They continue to move. Amen. So we want to get in a stream, the living stream of God Almighty, the life stream, where we're speaking what he spoke. Because what you speak is what you eat, and what you eat is what you become. Amen. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel, that they bring me an offering from everyone who gives it willingly. With his heart, you shall take my offering. Now, don't get goofy on me. I'm not trying to pass a bucket around, all right? Hallelujah. Verse 3. And this is the offering which you shall take from them, gold, silver, and bronze, blue, purple, and scarlet thread, fine linen and goat's hair, ram skins dyed red, badger skins, and acacia wood, oil for the light and spices for the anointing oil for the sweet incense, onyx stones, stones to be set in the ephod and the breastplate. And let them make me a what?
Sanctuary.
Let them make me a what?
Sanctuary.
A sanctuary. That I may what? Dwell among them. According to all that I show you, that is the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all its furnishings, just as you shall make it. Now, so grab hold. God was setting up a sanctuary, a tabernacle, somewhere where he could dwell with man. because he couldn't dwell in them yet. Amen. So it had to be sanctified. It had to be a place of sanctification. Men cannot just get to near the tabernacle. They would not live. Amen. They would die because God is a holy God, a righteous God. Amen. But he loves us so much that he wanted to come and dwell with man somehow, some way. What he wanted to really do, and I'm going to share this, is restore reality. Amen. He wanted to do what? Restore reality. A sanctuary for the Creator to dwell with his creation so that reality would not only be restored, but maintained. Because there had been, reality had been lost. It's called fallen from reality. Mankind had fallen from reality. They've lost. It began to drift consistently as time went on. In Exodus 26. In verse 31. Now, he told him to build this sanctuary known as the tabernacle so he could dwell with them. When God built the sanctuary and the tabernacle, he didn't start from the outer court in. He started from the most inner court. Because it was God getting ready, prepared to dwell with man. And he says in verse 31, you shall make a veil. Everyone say veil. Woven of blue, purple, and scarlet thread, and fine woven linen. Why? Because these were the things that he was taking an offering from the people. Well, he had created these things already. He gave mankind already the knowledge to, and all the material to create, so that they can bring these offerings to the Lord to build a sanctuary for some place for him to build, so that he could dwell with them. So it says that you shall make a veil woven of blue, purple, and scarlet thread, and fine woven linen. It shall be woven with an artistic design of a what? Cherubim. An angel. A strong angel. There are certain different types of angels. And you shall hang it upon the four pillars of acacia wood overlaid with gold. Their hooks shall be gold upon four sockets of silver. And you shall hang the veil from the clasps. Then you shall bring the ark of the testimony in behind the veil. This first place that he was building was called the most holy place. That ark of the covenant is where the mercy seat was. And he said, the veil shall be a divider between for you between the what? Holy place and the most holy place. So the most holy place was being built first, then the holy place, then the outer court. So everybody got it? You shall put the mercy seat upon the ark of the testimony in the most holy. You shall set the table outside the veil and the lampstand across the table on the side of the tabernacle toward the south. And you shall put the table on the north side. You shall make a screen for the door of the tabernacle, woven of blue, purple, and scarlet thread, fine woven linen made by a weaver. And you shall make for the screen five pillars of acacia wood and overlay them with gold. Their hooks shall be gold, and you shall cast five sockets of bronze before them. The veils were separation. They were separating each chamber. There was three chambers. Veils of separation reflect three-dimensional realities also. The tabernacle is so important. When people begin to understand that when God created the tabernacle, he was bringing a reality to mankind. And in this reality of mankind, all truth was revolved around the tabernacle and in the tabernacle. Everything of all creation, everything God is and did was associated with the tabernacle. So many people don't even get the tabernacle. They have no idea. The tabernacle had three chambers. The outer court, the holy place, and the most holy place. Representation of, we're made of three parts, a spirit, soul, and body. There is a triune God, known the Father, the Word, and the Spirit. Amen? So in this, God was establishing something. Why? He wanted to restore reality. Because from the time and fall, reality had been drifted away. There had been intervention of demonic forces. imparting deception, drifting away from reality of who we are, where we came from, and where we belong. These were veils of separation, and they reflect three-dimensional realities. Again, the outer court, the holy place, and the most holy place. Jesus, when he came, was known as the way, the truth, and the life, representing each chamber of the tabernacle, because he is the tabernacle of God. Does everybody get it? Jesus came so that he could expose and conquer and restore all realities of his creation for mankind, because mankind had drifted from reality. As he fought and battled in prayer, the word tells us that Jesus prayed three times. In fact, he prayed so hard. He told his disciples, wait here. He was in the Garden of Gethsemane before they came and took him and hung him on the cross. He said, hang here, I'm going to go pray. He said, now stay awake and pray also. And he went and prayed, and he came back, and his soul was so sorrowful. And he said one of the things, he said, Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass me by, but not my will, your will, because I came to do your will. See, God came to do his own will. He came to fulfill his own will. And he went back to his disciples, and they were falling asleep. He said, what's the matter? You guys couldn't hang with me for an hour? Come on, wake up and pray. Why? He said, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. He said, and if you're not watchful in prayer, you're going to be taken by temptation. And he went and prayed again, and he said the same things, Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass me by, but not my will, your will. See, he was interceding for each chamber of the tabernacle and each dimensional reality. He had to win every single one in prayer before he could go and win anything else. And he had to win by prayer, because the battle is not seen, it's unseen. And it's won in prayer, spiritual warfare. And he came back to his disciples again. But this time he came back, before he came back, his third time in prayer, he had to fight so hard. Because remember, he started now fighting for the outer court first, then the holy place, then the most holy place. By the time he was fighting for the most holy place, he was sweating blood, because his body couldn't handle the presence of God. His body couldn't handle that fight, and he began to drip blood. And then he said, it's done. See, he won and died in prayer. That's how they were able to sacrifice him. Because if he just went out there as God Almighty, he would have killed everybody. He said, that's it. Devil, you ain't doing this. You ain't doing this. And you ain't hanging me. This is over with. Called fire down on everything, destroyed the whole universe, and started a brand new one. That's how some of us would have been. That's it. Hallelujah. Mankind had begun to drift from reality. It started with the fall in the garden. See, remember, their eyes were open. They saw God face to face. They saw angels. Amen? Amen. It started in the fall in the garden when eyes were closed to see God and angelic beings. Why? Because of they committing the act of sin, the presence of sin, of rebellion and perversion, which happened in the garden. It removed their visual reality with God Almighty. The veil came on their eyes. A veil came on their eyes. And now the only reality they had was no longer visual. It was hearing. So everybody got it. There was no more visual reality. Of course, we know that in the Old Testament, there was visitations of angels, wasn't there? Amen. Oh, hallelujah. There were visitations of angelic messengers from God. And the tabernacle was being built. sanctuaries of visitations that were other places built, maintained reality, but Satan's kingdom enforced false realities. He defiled, he corrupted, and diffused the earth from all truth. Until again, Jesus came to restore reality and empower children of reality until the first reality overcomes all realities forever. Now, I'm going to talk about that in a minute, but I want to finish this first. Let me bring you to the first reality, Ezekiel chapter 1. Is everybody okay? Ezekiel chapter 1. Verse 2. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. On the fifth day of the month, which was in the fifth year of King Jehoiakim's captivity, the word of the Lord came, especially to Ezekiel the priest and the son of Buzi, in the land of the Chaldeans by the river Shebar. And the hand of the Lord was upon him there. Then I looked, and behold, a what? Whirlwind was coming out of the north, a great cloud with raging fire engulfing itself, and brightness all around, and radiating out of its midst like the color of amber out of the midst of the fire. Also, from within it came the likeness of four living creatures, and this was their appearance. They had the likeness of a man. Each one had four faces, and each one had four wings. Their legs were straight. Their soles of their feet were like the soles of calf feet. They sparkled like the color of burnished bronze. The hands of a man were under their wings on their four sides, and each of the four had faces and wings. Their wings touched one another. The creatures did not turn when they went, but each one went straight forward. For the likeness of their faces, each had the face of a man. Each of the four had the face of a lion on the right side. Each had the face of an ox on the left side. And each had the face of an eagle. These were their faces. Their wings stretched upward. Two wings of each one touched one another, and two covered their bodies. Each one went straight forward. They went wherever the Spirit wanted to go, and they did not turn when they went. As for the likeness of the living creatures, their appearance were like burning coals of fire, like the appearance of torches going back and forth among the living creatures. The fire was bright, and out of the fire went lightning. The living creatures ran back and forth in appearance like a flash of lightning. Now, as I looked at the living creatures, behold, a wheel was on the earth beside each living creature with its four faces. The appearance of the wheels and their workings was like the color of braille, and all four had the same likeness. The appearance of their workings was as it were a wheel in the midst of a wheel. When they moved, they went toward any one of the four directions. They did not turn aside when they went. As for their rims, they were so high, they were awesome, and their rims were full of eyes all around the four of them. When the living creatures went, the wheels went beside them. And when the living creatures were lifted up from the earth, the wheels were lifted up. Wherever the Spirit wanted to go, they went, because there the Spirit went, and the wheels were lifted together with them. For the Spirit of the living creatures was in the wheels. When those went, these went. When those stood, these stood. And when those were lifted up from the earth, the wheels were lifted up together with them. For the Spirit of the living creatures was in the wheels. The likeness of firmament above the heads of the living creatures was like the color of an awesome crystal stretched out over their heads. And under the firmament, their wings spread out straight, one toward another. Each one had two which covered one side, and each one had two which covered the other side of the body. When they went, I heard the noise of their wings, like the noise of many waters, like the voice of the Almighty, a tumult like a noise of an army. And when they stood still, they let down their wings. A voice came from above the firmament that was over their heads. Whenever they stood, they let down their wings. And above the firmament over their heads was a likeness of a throne, an appearance like a sapphire stone. And like the likeness of a stone was a likeness with the appearance of a man high above it. Also from the appearance of his waist and upward, I saw as it were the color of amber with the appearance of fire all around within it. And from the appearance of his waist and downward, I saw as it were the appearance of fire with brightness all around. Like the appearance of a rainbow in a cloud on a rainy day, so was the appearance of the brightness all around it. This was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of the Lord. When I saw it, I fell on my face, and I heard the voice of one speaking. This is the first reality. This is known as the eternal tabernacle of God. This is where things started from. Does everybody get it? This was the throne room of the Lord God Almighty. That was the first reality in the third dimension. I'm going to explain the dimensions. Remember, for me and you, this is the first dimension. There's another dimension. Then there's a third dimension. In the third dimension is the throne room of God. This is what, but it's actually the first reality. Does everybody understand that? So even though it's the third dimension, it's actually the first reality where everything originated from. Is everybody okay? Good. It's known as the kingdom of God. Let's go to the second reality. Ephesians chapter 6. Glory. Ephesians 6. Just think, we're going there. Actually, we're from there. Everyone say, I'm from. The third reality, the first reality. I'm from the first reality, from the third dimension. Everybody got it? I'm from the first reality, from the what dimension? Third dimension. That's where you're from. That's why everybody likes to feel good. That's why we did what we did. Drugs, sex, drugs, rock and roll, and all the other stuff to feel good. Why? Because we came from the Most High. I love to get high. But I get high from the first reality in the third dimension now. No longer from this place. So we worship to press in to get to the third dimension where the first reality is. So we can get high. Glory. Why? What's it say? It says the presence of the Lord is what? In the presence of the Lord is fullness of what? Joy. And the joy of the Lord is our what? Strength. Praise God. Okay, Ephesians 6:10. Second reality. Second dimension. Second reality, second dimension. Let's speak. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and what? Power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles or the trickery of the devil. Here we go. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against the powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against what? Spiritual hosts of wickedness where? In heavenly places. And what heavenly place is that? It is the second reality and the second dimension. Everybody got it? Let's go a little further. I like this. Therefore what? Take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. That's in this dimension. And having done all to stand. Everybody got it? Good. Second reality is the kingdom of Satan. The third reality is the kingdom of God. The second reality is Satan's, the third dimension and first reality is the kingdom of God. First reality is the kingdom of God. Second reality is the kingdom of Satan. Everybody got it? Let's go to Genesis chapter 1. First reality is in the third dimension. The second reality is in the second dimension. Snap. Try and say that 15 times. You'd be praying in tongues if you tried. Genesis chapter 1. You know, when the Holy Spirit was bringing this to me, one of the things he kept sharing with me is, again, he's grieving for the lost. People that have been taken deception. Taken captive. They don't know. And there are still too many believers that are still in the outer court, never even reached the second chamber where they have power. Look at, you must fight for every place. You must have a willing desire. God will never give you something you don't have a desire for. Look at, when that desire comes, you know what he says? Show me. Show me. Show me you're willing to do whatever it takes. Show me. That's what he said to me. I said, man, I need help. He said, guy, you want to get off of drugs and alcohol? You want a new life? And I realized I tried to get off the drugs and alcohol, and it didn't work because I still wanted to live the life, but without the drugs and alcohol. And you know what? I needed a new life. Amen. And when I said I want a new life, you know what he said to me? Show me. Show me you want a new life. And I did whatever it took. I was still trying to manage those demons that were kicking my butt. I about locked myself in my house so I wouldn't go use. Then I got rescued. The Lord sent someone that I used to use with, that he had been cleaned and saved. I used to ride Harleys with him. And he came by and he said, man, you need Jesus. And I said, man, everybody goes to Jesus for drugs and alcohol. Get out of here. But Jesus didn't give up on me. And I finally gave in. Because I had nothing else to lose. Amen. I was getting ready to go back to prison. What did I have to lose? I finally lost it all again. Came to my wit's end. It's like, that's it. Okay, let's do something. I accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. I didn't know he was going to show up. Surprise. When he showed up, I died. And I keep him buried. See, you got to keep the old man buried. Amen. Down, boy! It's like a chihuahua that gnaws at your ankles, you know? Down! But the only way to keep him down is stay filled with the Spirit of God. Amen. You must eat the Word and drink the Spirit so you have power over the old man and over the powers of darkness. Is everybody okay? Amen. All right, let's get to the first dimension, right? And third reality. Third reality, first dimension. Everybody there? Genesis 1, let's speak it. In the beginning, God created the what? Heavens, which was the what? First reality. Everybody got it? And then the what? Earth, which is the third reality. Why? Because at this time, the second reality wasn't manifested. When he created the... Does everybody get it? The second reality wasn't created. It brought forth itself when Lucifer stepped out of light into darkness. Second reality was manifested. Oh, snap. Revelation 12, we'll talk about that for a minute. Revelation chapter 12. We want truth, right? Anyways, the Holy Spirit was sharing with me that because of this, he wanted something to go out so that the unknown would know. Something simple. So you'll be able to get this teaching and hand it to everybody that's an unbeliever. And for some people that are in the outer court, you can hand it to them too. Glory. Revelation 12. Is everybody there? And we've heard this one before in verse 7. Come on now. And what does it say? And war broke out in heaven. Where? What reality was this? First reality. This is the first reality. War broke out. Why? Because Lucifer rebelled. So war broke out. And it says, and Michael and his angels fought with the dragon. And the dragon and his angels fought, verse 8, but they did not prevail, nor was a place found to them in heaven any longer. So they are no longer have any access to the first reality. In fact, they are shut off of the first reality. They do not know God's love. They don't know God's mercy. And they don't know God's grace. The only thing they know is hatred. To steal, kill, destroy, and deceive. They live for that. In Satan's kingdom, there's no love whatsoever. None. No love. Verse 9. So the great dragon was cast out, the what? Serpent of old, called the devil and Satan, who what? Deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. He deceives the whole world from what? First reality. He'll do everything he can to prevent you from knowing who you are. He does everything he can from prevent you from being empowered from on high and having access to the first reality. Because if he can keep you bound to the second and third reality, you are no danger to his kingdom. Is everybody okay? Verse 10. Then I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now salvation and strength in the kingdom of our God and the power of his what? Christ has come. That's when Jesus came. To what? Restore what? First reality. To allow mankind to have access to the first reality. His throne. For the accuser of our brethren who accused them before our God day and night has been what? Cast down. Verse 11. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives to death. Therefore rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them. First reality. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth. Third reality. And the sea, for the devil has come down to you having great wrath because he knows that he is a what? A short time. Now look at this. Now when the dragon saw that he was cast to the earth, he persecuted the what? The woman who gave birth to the what? Male child. Well, hello. Aren't you now children of reality? So we see here that the third reality is known as the earth. Satan, Lucifer, was removed from the first reality. And when he was removed from the throne room of God, the second reality was created, known as the second dimension. Why? Because of exalting himself above God, he was sent to the earth to serve under Adam. I'm going to say it again. He was sent to the earth to serve under Adam. Him and the fallen angels were to serve under Adam. He lost his beauty, his love, and became a serpent, bitter, evil, a liar, a murderer, and hateful. Again, there was no love or compassion or mercy. He came to steal, kill, and destroy by deceptions, being unseen to mankind. His strategies are always out to set a trap for you and me, to get us bound, to bring us back to the old ways, to fall, have us fall into sin and fornication. His purpose is to keep mankind deceived from and prevent them from seeing him, keeping mankind in a constant drift of reality. That's his purpose, so that mankind can constantly drift from reality. And he's been doing a very good job. Wow. He can prevent them from the first reality, which is in the third dimension. The second reality, again, is Satan's kingdom in the second dimension, right? He caused the fall of Adam. So everybody got this? In the garden. He caused the fall of Adam and Eve. Well, he caused Eve to question God. And again, remember, Adam and Eve walked with God face to face. Their eyes were open, weren't they? So because of that, when they fell, first reality was shut off to all mankind. All mankind lost the access to God Almighty from the garden. And a veil came on all mankind's eyes and on their heart. From that time until Jesus came. Is everybody okay? 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Oh, hallelujah. In verse 16. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 16. It says what? Is everybody there? Therefore, what? We do not lose heart, even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceedingly and eternal weight of glory, while we do not look at the things which are what? Seen. What reality? Come on. Third reality in what dimension? First dimension. So everybody got it? For the things which are seen are what? Temporary in the what? Come on, what reality? Third reality, first dimension. So everybody got it? Good job. But the things which are not seen are what? Eternal, which is the what? First reality. Third dimension. Hold on a second. First reality, third dimension. This is the first dimension here. Then there's the second dimension and the third dimension. Remember, we got to look at it from us dimensionally. We're looking at it from us dimensionally. We're in the first dimension. Then there's the second dimension, which is Satan's kingdom. Then there's the third dimension, which is God's throne. But the realities are from God. First God. Amen? In his throne, which is in the third dimension. Good job. Satan's kingdom is the second reality in the second dimension. Has everybody got it? Good. And you and I are on the, which one? Third reality, first dimension. Yeah, give yourself a hand. Praise God. Snap it. So the seen, the temporary realm is called the third reality, first dimension. Amen? We'll get it. Job chapter 1. Job, it's the employment section in the Bible. Job chapter 1, verse 6. Let's speak it. Now there was a day when the what? Sons of God, which are known as angels, came to present themselves before the Lord. All right. What dimension did they come? They came from the third dimension. Good job. Into the what? First reality. Amen. Okay, now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them. And the Lord said to Satan, "From where do you come?" Like he didn't know. He wanted to know if he was still lying. So Satan answered the Lord and said, "From going to and fro," where? "On the earth, and from walking back and forth on it." Then the Lord said, "Have you considered my what? Servant Job, that there is none like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and what? Shuns evil." So Satan answered the Lord and said, "Does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not made it what? Hedge around him, around his household, and around all that he has on every side. You have blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land." Now, this is powerful because here the Lord saw Job. He still maintained an understanding of reality. Why? Because he feared God and hated evil. He had a reverence and honor and respect to the Lord, and he hated evil. Why? Because he still had an understanding of the first reality. Amen? He was maintaining it. And God gave him a hedge. In fact, God gave him all kinds of cattle and so forth so that he could sacrifice every single day. So blood was being shed every day for a hedge of protection. See, grab hold of this, because as we are children of reality, we are sons and daughters of reality. We are servants of reality. We first start out as a child of reality, then we come into sons and daughters of reality, then we go into servants of reality. Does everybody got it? So there's a process of learning, isn't there? God says, "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge." It is also associated with the three chambers of the tabernacle. Outer court is child. Second chamber is son and daughter. And third chamber is servant, or what we call warrior. Has everybody got it? In the second chamber, we also call it priesthood. Is everybody okay? All right, let's go a little further. John chapter 1. Verse 14. Is everybody there? John chapter 1, verse 14. "And the Word became flesh." And where did the Word come from? What reality? First reality. What dimension? Third dimension. Good job. "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." So he came from the first reality, third dimension, into the first dimension and third reality. All right, let's go to verse 10 and seal this up here. Verse 10, are you with me? So the Word became flesh, right? God Almighty came in from the first reality to the third reality. And what happened? And he came to his what? Verse 10. "He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of reality." Why? Because that's how it starts. You go from child to son and daughter and to servant. To those who what? Believed in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of the man, but of God. Born in the Spirit. Children of reality. Again, it starts off as a child and goes from son to daughter, then to servants of reality. So everybody got it. You and I are servants of reality. Romans 8. Hallelujah. Romans 8, verse 12. Let's speak it together. Is everybody there? Therefore, brethren, we are what? Debtors not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will what? You will die. You will die. Hallelujah. Verse 13. Is everybody there? If you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God. Wait a minute. Where's the Spirit of God from? First reality. First reality, third dimension. So the Spirit of God came through Jesus Christ. Why? So you and I could be led by the first reality and be sons of the what? Sons and daughters of reality. Do y'all get this? Some of yours. Wind it up. All right, are you ready? Verse 14. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are called sons of God or sons of what? Reality. If you're led by the first reality, you're a son and daughter of the first reality. Verse 5 or 15. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to what? Fear. So who interrupts that reality? What causes you to drift? Satan. By what? Fear. Causes a person to drift. But you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. Are you ready? Verse 16, let's speak it together. For the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of what? God and children of what? Reality. So you're not here by mistake. And verse 17. And if children, then heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if we indeed suffer with him, that we may also be what? Glorified together. Oh, come on, let's go. We're going to go a little further with this. Are you ready? Verse 18. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Wait a minute. That glory is from the first reality. Verse 19. Now remember, when Adam and Eve fell, it set up a veil, didn't it? All the earth was corrupt. Everything got corrupted. Everything. Why? Because Satan took over. He became ruler of this earth. Remember, he was removed. And then he came to serve Adam, but then he tricked Eve and caused Eve and Adam to fall. From that point on, there's been veils between these dimensions until Jesus came. But still, the earth is still corrupt and messed up because it's still ruled by Mr. Corruption himself. Verse 19. Are you ready? For the earnest expectation of creation eagerly waits for the revealing of the sons of God or the sons of what? Reality. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willing, but because of him who subjected it in hope. Because the creation itself also will be delivered from the what? From the bondage of what? Corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God, where everything at some time is going to be restored to its full reality. For we know that the whole Creation groans and labors with birth pains together until now. Not only that, but we also, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, eagerly waiting for the adoption, the redemption of our body. In other words, that will bring the fullness where we are able to be restored to the first reality. We're waiting for the body, the first reality body to be restored, the glorified body. Oh, yes. Hallelujah. Are you ready? Verse 24. For we were saved in this hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For why does one still hope for what he sees? Because that's not the first reality. But if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for what? For what? With perseverance, endurance. 2 Corinthians 3. This teaching. Oh, she's here. Hi. Everybody needs to hear this.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Why? So we can pass it on.
Amen.
Amen. We need to pass it on. 200 people are taking captivity.
Amen.
Is everybody there?
Amen.
Where are we at? 2 Corinthians 3? All right, let's start at verse 12 then. But their minds were what? Oh, that's 14, sorry. Verse 12. Therefore, since we have such hope, we use great boldness of speech, unlike Moses, who put a veil over his face so that the children of Israel could not look steadily at what? At the end of what was passing away. Why? Now check this out. That veil is still representation of separation. Moses had the veil on his face because he was in the presence of the glory of God. And in that glory, it was fading. But it still represents symbolically a veil that was between the presence of the glory of God, which was on man, on Moses, and man. That veil was a separation from the glory of God and man. Does everybody get it? That was symbolic. That's why Moses put the veil on. He was not known as the unknown preacher. They knew him. Hello. Verse 14. It says, but they're what? Now, wait a minute. I want to do verse 13 again so we get understanding. Unlike Moses, who put a veil over his face so that the children of Israel could not look steadily at the end of what was passing away. That was prophetic things that it was going to, that veil was eventually going to get passed away. By the price Jesus paid. Verse 14. Is everybody there? But their minds were blinded until this day. The same veil remains unlifted in the reading of the Old Testament because the veil is taken away in Christ. Now, wait a minute. Christ, remember the power of Christ. See, because even if when you become a believer, the veil is, there's a process of it removing. But when you get baptized in the Holy Spirit, that veil is gone. Everybody got it? Because the veil is actually removed in the second chamber, but the process gets from the first chamber to the second chamber. Is everybody with me? So when you become a believer in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you've entered the outer court, which is the first chamber. Amen? That's still the first dimension, but it's the third reality, isn't it? We need to get out of that into the second reality with power, which is the second chamber of God. And that's when the scales come off so you can understand the spiritual fight. Other than that, in the first chamber, you're still calling out on Jesus all the time. Jesus, help me. Jesus, well, you don't fight. You're waiting. You want everybody else to fight for you. And people are interceding for you. But in that second chamber, you become priesthood. And then you desire to get into the third chamber, which is the most holy place. And you're not only a son and daughter of reality, but you are a servant to reality because you fight for reality. Verse 15. So the Christ is associated with the eternal presence, power, and truth of God Almighty, which is the anointing, and which is also the voice of God. Verse 15, but even to this day, when Moses is read, a veil lies on their what? On their hearts, on their minds, on their eyes. Nevertheless, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is what? Taken away. Now he's going to tell you who the Lord is. How does the veil get taken away? Are you ready? Now the Lord is the what? Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is what? Freedom or liberty. But we all, with unveiled face, beholding in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. Praise God. So when you are baptized in the Holy Spirit, that veil is removed. And now you've entered the second chamber, second dimension, and you can have access to the first reality of the third dimension. Has everybody got it? Don't ask me to repeat that. So the veil, the first reality, entering the holy place with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the second chamber, and access to the second dimension, and the second reality where Satan's kingdom or his realm is, through the battle that you and I fight. And then, of course, as we fight through, we have access to the first reality and the third dimension with worship and praise as warriors of the Most High. Hebrews 9. So, actually, Lucifer created a dimensional split. Does everybody understand that? He created a dimensional split. I brewed this morning. Hebrew. Any Hebrews? Hallelujah. Hebrews 9. Is everybody okay? Are you getting this? Mankind has fallen from reality and been taken up by deception. It needs to be restored. And it's going to be restored by its sons and daughters of reality. Verse 6, please. Hebrew 9, verse 6. Let's speak it. Now, when these things had been thus prepared, the priests always went into the first part of the tabernacle, performing the services. But in the second part, the high priest went alone once a year, not without blood, which he offered for himself and for the people's sins committed in ignorance. The Holy Spirit indicating this, that the way into the holiest of all, which is the most holy, was not yet made manifest while the first tabernacle was still standing. That was for mankind. That was through Moses. It was what? Symbolic for the present time in which both gifts and sacrifices are offered, which cannot make him who performed the service perfect in regard to the conscience. And concerned only with foods and drinks, various washings, and fleshy ordinances imposed until the time of Reformation. But Christ did what? He came as high priest of the good things to come with a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is not of this creation. Not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood, he entered the most holy place once and for all, having obtained eternal redemption. For if the blood of bulls and goats and of the ashes of the heifer, sprinkling the unclean, sanctifies for purifying the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, cleanse your what? Conscience from dead works to serve the living God. And for this reason, he is the what? Mediator of the new covenant by means of death for the redemption of the transgressions under the first covenant, that those who are called, everyone say, I'm called, may receive the promise of eternal inheritance. Has everybody got that? Jesus makes access. That's why when he died on the cross, the temple that was built, the veil ripped, whoosh, opened right up. Why? Removing the dimensional separation so that mankind could now have access to God the Father and the main throne room, the first reality, to those who are his sons and daughters. James chapter 1. So does the enemy want to constantly try to get you back and take away reality from you? Yes. He causes individuals to drift from reality and they fall and get caught up in their own life. They fight more for their own possessions than all the other garbage. James chapter 1, verse 21. Is everybody there? Let's speak it, please. James 1:21. Therefore, lay aside all what? Filthiness. Why? Will that cause a drift of reality? Yes. An overflow of wickedness. And receive with the meekness the implanted word which is able to save your souls. But what? Be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourself. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in a mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was, or he forgets what? Reality. But he who looks in the perfect law of liberty and what? Continues in it, and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this one will be blessed in what he does. If anyone among you thinks he's religious and does not bridle his tongue, but deceives his own heart, this one's religion is useless. Pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their trouble and to keep oneself what? Unspotted from the world. Why? Because if you get yourself spotted from the world, you'll begin to drift from reality. Hebrews 2. So you think it's important to fellowship. Amen. You think it's important to abide. You think it's important to constantly praise and worship the Lord. You think it's important to read the word and speak the word and decree. Amen. Because what you speak is what you eat. How much more what time is spent. Amen. That's why Jesus said, forsake not to assemble and forsake not to abide. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 1. Are you ready for this? Therefore, we must what? Give more in earnest heed, that means here, to the things which we have heard, lest we what? Lest we what? And what are we going to drift away from? Reality. Man, you'll be spending more time doing all kinds of other stuff. Verse 2. For if the word spoken through angels proves steadfast and every transgression and disobedience received a just reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed to us by those who heard him? God also bearing witness both with signs and wonders, with various miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit according to his own will. For he has not put to the world to come of which we speak in subjection to angels. But one testified in a certain place saying, are you ready for this? What is man that you are mindful of him? Or the son of man that you take care of him? Who's he talking about? Us. Sons and daughters of reality. You have made him a little lower than the angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor. You have set him over the works of whose hands? God's hands. You have put all things in subjection under his feet. For in that he put all subjection under him, he left nothing that is not to put under him. But now we do not yet see all things put under him. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels, for the sufferings of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, might taste death for everyone. For it was fitting for him, for whom all things, and by whom all things, in bringing many sons to glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For both he who sanctifies and those who are being sanctified are all one. For which reason he is not ashamed to call them brethren, saying, I will declare your name to my brethren. In the midst of the, where? In the assembly, I will what? Sing praise to you. So does Jesus show up and sing praise when we sing praise? You betcha. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again, here am I, the children whom God has given me. Because we are children of reality. Inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the what? The devil. And release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. For indeed he does not give aid to angels. Well, let me share this with you. Aid goes to angels by you and me that are working on our behalf. Why? By you binding, blinding, mutant, deafening principalities and powers of darkness that are coming against the angels working on your behalf. Aid comes from us to them. Is everybody okay? For indeed he does not give aid to angels, but he does give aid to the seed of Abraham. Therefore, in all things, he had to be made like his brethren, that he might be merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. For verse 18, for in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to aid those who are what? Tempted. He's able to make a way of escape for every temptation. And I'm going to close at Romans 8:31. Or fallen from reality. Mankind has fallen from reality. Romans 8. We were sent by God from the first reality into this third reality. From the third dimension into the first dimension. We were sent by God to fulfill a mission. To bring reality to those who have been taken captive from reality. That's our mission. Amen? We want to fulfill it. You can never be satisfied until you fulfill it, no matter what you do. Verse 31, let's speak it. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? Yes. He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all. How shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? Who's God's elect? We are sons and daughters of reality. Come on, read it. It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Hallelujah. Who shall what? Separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers nor things present nor things to come nor height nor depth nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Praise God. Father, we are honored and blessed for your fresh rhema today, a nugget from the first reality in the third dimension, that we may be connected. Oh, lift your hands to heaven. Lord, we surrender. We surrender. We cast our cares and concerns. We surrender. We lift our hands to heaven with understanding of the first reality as sons and daughters, as children of reality. as servants of reality. That the reality of who you are and who we are in you will become so real to each and every one here. That our identities would be restored as from the beginning. And that we would not only maintain our identity, but reality. So, Father, we thank you. We thank you. I know you're preparing us for the things that are getting ready to come so that we may share true reality with others and rescue from the deception and death, the depths, pain and hurt, and the glorious liberty of your kingdom. In Jesus' mighty name.